Good afternoon. My name is Craig Boyce, and I'm the Dean of the Cleveland Marshall College of Law here at Cleveland State University. And it's my great pleasure to welcome each of you this afternoon to this great event. Here at Cleveland State University, we spend a lot of time thinking about a little word called engagement. And you may have seen this on signs as you've walked through the campus here. Engaged learning. It's our commitment to make sure that every one of our students has the opportunity during the course of their CSU education to engage community leaders, to engage business leaders, nonprofit organizations, employers, in short, the world beyond our campus during the course of their education. Having the opportunity to host an event like today's lecture gives us as a university an opportunity to also engage, to engage with the community around a very important, very critical issue, and that is the current health of our civil liberties as we are now more than a decade into the 21st century. Today's event is also a great reminder of the fact that the ACLU is out there every day, jealously and zealously advocating and protecting the civil liberties of Americans. So welcome to the CSU, welcome to our campus. We thank you for coming here today. We thank you for supporting the work of the ACLU. I hope that you enjoy the 2013 Ed Likover Memorial Lecture. Thank you.
So you hear that? Yeah. I think this is the largest gathering of civil libertarians we have ever had in Cleveland.
Wow.
I'm Chris Saint. I'm the executive director of the ACLU of Ohio. Something else inspiring besides the size of the room is that Belle Likover is celebrating her 94th birthday.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
Belle fights on as one of the hardest working and smartest strategists. And I have to say smartest strategist. She taught me a thing or two a couple weeks ago among us. Happy birthday, Belle. Something else inspiring, in case you missed it on public radio, or if you missed the New York Times this week, in case you missed every daily, well, kind of daily, major Ohio newspaper.
Was that necessary?
Yeah. Just saying. In case you missed it, on Wednesday, ACLU of Ohio, with support from ACLU lawyers across the country, filed a lawsuit in state court to stop anti-choice amendments added to the state budget. Yeah. Literally, hours before the budget passed, those amendments were added with no hearings, no legislative process, no constituent input. The litigation is led by volunteer attorneys Professor Jesse Hill of Case Western Reserve University Law School and ACLU board member attorney Susan Scheitzel. Susan, are you here? She's out in the parking lot, I know. Susan is a senior partner at the Cleveland law firm Corman, Jackson, and Krantz, which is lending its full support to this effort, allowing a team of young attorneys to work with Susan on this complicated litigation. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce you to my boss, the new president of the ACLU of Ohio Board of Directors. Jack Guttenberg is a member of the faculty at Cap Law School in Columbus, Capital Law School in Columbus. He and his partner, Steffi Cartwright, reside there, but they hold dual passports with Cleveland, where they lived for a number of years. Jack, having taught at Cleveland Marshall College of Law, and Stephanie teaching children with disabilities at Fairfax Elementary in Cleveland Heights. They're great Cleveland antecedents. Jack has spent a lifetime of working in positions that demand a lot of compassion and energy, and are made so much easier by his great sense of humor. In addition to being a teacher and formerly law school dean, Jack started out as a public defender, then a criminal defense attorney, until he launched his career as a teacher of lawyers. Jack joined the ACLU board 3 years ago and made a rapid rise to the presidency. Now, this rise could be attributed to raw ambition on his part. But most likely when he said, really, Jack, it won't be that much work to be board president of a statewide organization covering the most controversial issues of our times, with funding challenges, and with board meetings that last most of a weekend, not that much work. So Jack might be vulnerable to a little guilt tripping and arm twisting, or maybe he's mostly vulnerable to a call to serve rather than raw ambition. Whichever the motivator, we're very lucky to have him as we navigate very difficult times through equality and justice, usually making almost everybody unhappy with us as we move along. Jack has proven to be a wonderful spokesperson for civil liberties. His commitment to changing a system that is increasingly unfair and unequal, his knowledge of constitutional law, and his understanding of the business side of running a nonprofit organization are invaluable. Most importantly, his love for the work of the ACLU shines through wherever he represents us. In addition, Jack is deft at wrangling 25 civil libertarians, our board of directors, all of them determined to make a contribution, all of them pretty good talkers, and ever so convinced that their position is the right one, the only right one, and compromise unthinkable. Sisters and brothers, civil libertarians, please welcome Jack Guttenberg.
Chris, thank you for that wonderful introduction. But the message you should take away from that introduction is when Chris calls on the phone and you see that message that might pop up on your phone that says Chris Link, don't answer it. Because she is great at getting people to do things. And so when she called and I first said, no, I've got this, I've got that, I've got this, she called again. And eventually, you cannot turn down Chris Link. You cannot turn down the ACLU of Ohio. As Chris said, it's wonderful to be in this auditorium today, full of civil libertarians, full of people who have a strong commitment to protecting those liberties that are really dear to all of us. And it is a great honor of mine to be president of the board that really focuses on protecting our civil liberties every day. But the accomplishments of the ACLU, filing the lawsuit this past week, being in the legislature, lobbying against awful legislation, or cajoling and pushing some of the state legislatures toward good legislation, doesn't happen because we might have a dedicated board. It doesn't happen because we have a great staff. It really happens because of everybody coming together. It happens because through the generations, people have supported the ACLU and the work of the ACLU to let us know that we have a strong backing behind us. We have strong financial backing. We have strong friend backing. We have strong volunteer support. You know, and all of that comes together to let us build an ACLU of Ohio that really is out there day to day, fighting for civil liberties, fighting for people who in some ways can't defend themselves, fighting against legislation that attempts to brutalize, criminalize, and really change the society that we live in. And it's through activists, it's through people like, you know, Susan Scheitzau, who is in private practice, has a private practice every day that she has to attend to, but is willing to volunteer her time to take on a fairly complicated lawsuit, basically to take on the state of Ohio, and to tell it no, it can't do what it's attempting to do to women all over the state of Ohio. It's activists like that that really make us proud of what we do. And today in the auditorium, we have an activist that we can all be proud of. Someone who's really out there daily changing the world we live in. And, you know, her reputation as a person of principle, her reputation as an activist, her reputation as someone who's out there working on our behalf is you know, sort of paramount. And she does this, you know, willingly and unquestioningly, you know, sort of, when I talked to her earlier today, she said, I just like making trouble, and it really is fun. And so, you know, you've got to like what you're doing, you got to believe in what you're doing. Her husband, Ed Likover, believed in that, and it's people like Ed and Belle that really are role models to all of us, that really let us think about what we're doing on a day-to-day basis and let us walk back and say, we're not doing enough. Look at what these people are doing. Look at what, you know, the volunteer lawyers who work for the organization are doing. Look at what people like Belle Likover are doing. I could stand up here and not give Sherrod and Connie any time at all by going over Belle's accomplishments. You know, the easiest thing she's done recently is to turn 94. The hardest thing she's probably done is out there organizing in the community on a daily basis. You know, she established this lecture in honor of her husband. She's out there educating fellow citizens about their voting rights, defending the ACLU principles in the community. She's out there, I know recently she's been educating folks on the alternative, the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, as we proudly refer to it, getting people to understand their rights and doing it on a daily basis. You know, it's really, truly an honor. And it's almost humbling. I mean, I don't deserve to be up here introducing someone like Belle Likover. You know, but it really is an honor to bring her forward. She's an inspiration to all of us. She is what I consider really a role model. There aren't many, but she really is a role model that we can all strive to be like. And, you know, she's one of those people that I refer to who truly flunked retirement. You know, she just is the best example of someone who's flunked retirement. You know, you're supposed to slow down in retirement. She sped up. It freed her to do more organizing and more educating. Please join me in welcoming Belle Likover.
Overwhelmed, not only by that beautiful introduction, but by all the faces that I see out here. And I recognize most of them. Somewhere in my life, we have interacted. Can you hear me? Okay. I am vertically challenged, so I can't stand behind the podium, but I'll try to do the best I can with this. I said, this is an overwhelming kind of a congregation today. And it's because we have both Senator Sherrod Brown and his lovely wife, Connie, with us.
Only you would get away with it.
Who would miss up the opportunity of hearing both of them together? But before I turn it over to them, there are a few things that I would like to share with you. First of all, I want to thank my family. They have come from the East Coast and from the West Coast and from many points in between, and I'm delighted that they're all here with us today. But I have to tell you that, you know, I know that life is finite, that I won't be around so many years to fund this lecture. My children, my grown children, have decided that once I'm gone, they will continue to fund this lecture.
Stand up.
You did a good job. Just a few words about Ed. You all know how important civil liberties were to him. There were three things that were most important in his life. Number one was his family. Number two was civil liberties. And number three was his tennis game. I cannot tell you how many things revolved around the tennis game. But Ed always acted on the things that he believed in, even if he stood alone. And I'm going to give you an example. Many of you know that the last decade or so of his working life, he was had an office in the union, in the painters' union. And I remember going to an AFL CIO annual convention with him, where he got up on the floor and made a motion that all union officials should retire at the age of 65 to make room for the younger people and to keep infusing new ideas into the labor movement. When the vote was taken, there was one vote in favor, his vote. Everybody else voted against it. But when Ed was 65, he retired. And because he was retired, I retired shortly thereafter. I can't believe I've been retired for over 30 years. It's amazing to have a life that long. But I want to make sure that when I have an audience this big, I do not pass up an opportunity for advocacy. So there are several issues that I want to talk to you about, and they are not necessarily ACLU issues, but issues that affect all our lives. We all know that on November 5th, there is an election. And on that day, we will be voting for the Health and Human Service levy, a very important levy for all kinds of human services. I urge you to vote yes on issue one. And you have to realize that because it's an off-year election, it will probably be a small turnout. A few thousand votes can make a difference on whether or not issue one passes. If each one of you enlist 10 people that you know to vote yes on issue one, we can pass that levy. The other thing in terms of that election, if you are waiting to get an application for mail-in ballot, you will not get that application in the mail. But we have with us today applications for in-mail balloting, and it's out near the on the table near the refreshments, and if you need one of those, pick it up. The second issue that I would like to address is the whole question of Medicaid expansion. We know how important that is if Ohio took advantage of Obamacare and had Medicaid expansion. 275,000 people who do not have health care now would get it under Medicaid. The legislature keeps saying no. The governor said he's taking it to the controlling board this coming week to try to bypass the legislature. But another initiative that is going on is a a petition drive to try to force the legislature to pass Medicaid expansion. Again, outside next to the refreshment table, there's a table set up with petitions for Medicaid expansion. I urge you to please sign those. Now, let's get on with what we're really here for. And that is to hear, oh my. All right. I really don't mean to tear the place down. We are so lucky in Ohio to have Sherrod Brown as our senator. We all know that Senator Sherrod Brown, no matter what the issue is, if it's a question of civil liberties, if it's a question of jobs, if it's a question of anything that affects our lives, he's going to be there to vote with the needs of the 99% of us. We also know that Senator Sherrod Brown is totally incorruptible. He is not going to sell out to the highest payer. Along with Sherrod is his lovely wife, Connie. The Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, whose writing is so brilliant. She can take the most ordinary things that happen to us in everyday life and elevate them to the sublime. She makes us laugh, she makes us cry, and most importantly, she makes us think. We all look to we all look forward to, I know the first thing on Sunday morning when I get the Sunday paper, I get the parade magazine and say, are we gonna be lucky this weekend? And I have a, sometimes we're lucky, sometimes we're not. We look for her writing wherever we can find it. So it is my absolute honor and pleasure to introduce Senator Sherrod Brown, his lovely wife, Connie.
Don't you think so?
Yeah, I think we should.
Okay. So first, we should sing happy birthday. Ready?
Let's start.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Belle. Happy birthday to you.
Well, thank you. It's Connie's and my pleasure. We've done this no more than three or four times, appeared together and spoken together, and we're, when Bell Likover calls and says you're going to do this, you do it. So, in fact, I was yesterday, I mean, I just came back from Washington yesterday and go back early tomorrow morning, and Harry Reid said, if Bell Likover asks, you better show up. And then he said, I heard something about she likes making trouble. So, anyway, thank you, and thank you for Bell, thank you for your courage. And I had a moment during my 2012 campaign with listening to Bell and her former college roommate, my friend Jeremy Paris's grandmother, right? And tell a story of in the late 30s and early 40s, their time at Ohio State, and the courage that they showed on difficult issues, on free speech issues leading into World War II, and then kind of the decades after with her fight against her and Ed's fight against McCarthyism. And every decade, whether it's civil rights or human rights or women's rights or peace or choice, she's always leading the way. And this group of activists in this room, there are a lot of younger Bell Likovers in this room too, and I'm so thankful to all of you also. For your activism and your outspokenness and your courage on issues. As Jack knows, as Chris knows, the ACLU issues aren't always the most politically popular. That's why you do what you do, and thank you for that, for standing that way. Bell said that on the Sunday magazine, on the Sunday paper, once a month, you'll open it, and Connie's Parade magazine will be there. She also writes weekly for Creators Syndicate. And then she's working on a novel, but her column one time, I believe in an Alabama paper, her column on which the Creator Syndicate weekly column is, let's say, more political and opinionated than the Parade, which is more sort of about Franklin and pets and animals and family and friends and sort of human side issues that way. And so she gets an email from a guy about during the 2012 primary from a guy in Alabama, and it said that he had read, obviously, her political stuff, and he had read her family essays and Parade, and he wrote to her, how could somebody who is so nice to dogs be so mean to Rick Santorum?
And Connie, not missing an opportunity to respond and educate anybody, wrote back that something about, you know, women are complicated creatures, they can hold two thoughts, conflicting thoughts at the same time. And this guy, still not getting the point, wrote back and said, you sound like my wife. So, true story, right?
I didn't know you were going to tell that, yeah. So,
and I will tell another Connie story, and I'll talk a little bit about government shutdown. Connie,
I thought we agreed you weren't going to tell
that. No, we didn't agree. Yes, no, you wanted me not to, but I'm Connie and I were at a restaurant, a little reception of maybe 200-300 people in a room with no chairs and tables, so people were crowded very close together, and there were four or five senators, and we each kind of took the little stage about as high as this, just took a microphone to say thank you for 3 or 4 minutes. And Connie was standing next to a man she had never seen before, up close right next to him, and she, as I started to talk, this guy turned to Connie and said, I can't stand that guy's voice. And Connie said, really? He said, yeah, when he speaks, it's like fingernails on a blackboard. I can't stand listening to that guy. And Connie said, I like his voice. He said, you like that guy's voice? And she said, yeah, you know what, I really like it? And she goes like this, and he leans in, and she says, I really like it when he wakes me up in the middle of the night and says, I love you, baby. Anyway.
He deserved it. What do you think?
I've never tried, that guy left, I've never seen who said
our
that.
Our kids too. Hate that story, by the way. Hate that story.
This is a, as you know, a very difficult time for our country. We have seen, you know, with a number of legislative successes and country in some ways in the last 5 years with all of the terrible hardship inflicted on so many people, we've in some ways righted the ship and moving in the right direction. But we now see one faction of one political party in one house in one branch of government basically hold the government hostage, hold the government, shut the government down. And we, you can see the damage already that this has done. 800,000 federal employees are off. 97% of NASA employees are furloughed right now, as an example. And it means fewer dollars with sequester for Head Start and Meals on Wheels. And and people, food safety inspections and EPA and all the things that really form the American set of values of having a government that most of the time looks out for people, looks out for working families, looks out for poor people, not as well as we should, but generally going in that direction. And I mean, you can see what happened. I was talking to a guy that the head of Battelle Memorial Institute in Columbus. Battelle is sort of a federal, Ohio in some sense has three big federal facilities, NASA Glenn here, Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Dayton, and Battelle Memorial Institute, which is not exactly a federal facility, but it runs the energy labs all over the country. It is one of the biggest federal research facilities in the United States. And he said there's an asymmetry between building and killing a major scientific endeavor. It takes weeks, months, maybe years to build up a really important, whether it's aeronautics or whether it's medical research or whether it's any other kinds of research or scientific endeavor, and you shut it down for a period of time. Maybe it's a clinical trial for cancer. Maybe it's something with some intelligence thing in government. You shut it down for 2 or 3 or 4 weeks, and it does incalculable damage. Sam Rayburn, in a better, perhaps metaphoric way, Sam Rayburn said any jackass can kick down a barn, takes a carpenter to build one. And it really is, you know what that means. It means that, and it also means that scientists and engineers and medical researchers, places like Case, some of you here probably, have, after one government shutdown, after another, and a threat, every time there's a continuing resolution, every time there's an end of fiscal year, every time there's a debt ceiling, if there's a threat that they're going to close the government down unless whoever that is gets their way, whether it's Obamacare or anything else, who wants to work in those kinds of facilities? And so we do have the best medical research, the best engineers, the best scientists in the world, but we lose that edge, and we are losing that edge when those people get so impatient with a government that's run in many ways by people that hate government as much as they do in the House of Representatives and have such, not even disdain, but contempt for it. Do we keep that edge around the world? And that to me is troubling as anything during this whole government shutdown leading into what happens next week. I will talk for a second about, kind of try to explain from at least my perspective, why this intense anger from the far right at their country. I mean, it's an anger, a moderate Republican before they were extinct, told me about 15 years ago during the Gingrich shutdown, he said, you know, he's a Republican, but he was talking about his new colleagues, he said, they don't believe anything good happened in this country until they came to Congress. I mean, they don't have respect for Social Security or Medicare or safe drinking water laws or clean air laws or auto safety laws or the role of government in education, Pell Grants, Perkins. They don't have any real respect for what we as a nation consensually over decades, 80, 90% support, what we've developed as a nation. 40 times, as you know, the House of Representatives have voted to repeal Obamacare. They shut down the government over Obamacare. And I think the question's why. And fundamentally, they're afraid that Obamacare will work. That's fundamentally the problem. In fact, a Texas senator, whom you've seen on television a lot, I assume, Senator Cruz said that, you know, he was either talking on the, I think he was talking on the Beck show, Glenn Beck or Rush Limbaugh, maybe on both shows, he said, you know, it's like candy or sugar. They're going to get a sugar addiction. If you start giving them these benefits, they're going to like them, and they're going to get addicted to them, and they're not going to, you can't take them back from them. Well, there is something to that. And so they fear a couple of things if Obamacare, when the Affordable Care Act is totally rolled out and totally in effect. And I mean, I am almost certain 5 years from now, people will look back on this the way they look back on Medicare 5 years later in 1970 is, what was the fight about? This is working for our country. But fundamentally, they're afraid of two things. One is that Democrats will gain from this. because Democrats overwhelmingly voted for it and Republicans overwhelmingly voted against it. The public knows that. And Democrats will win elections in the future because of that, as Democrats have won elections because of Medicare and Social Security and environment and EEOC and Head Start and all the things that we believe in. But the other reason's more complicated. The other reason, I think, is their general, is the far right's general opposition to social insurance. Look back in 1930, in the 1930s, when Social Security came about. The far right, Roosevelt talked about the economic royalists who opposed any kind of a federal pension program, a government pension program, the first major pillar of social insurance. Then look at 1965. The John Birch, the doctors, the insurance companies opposed Medicare. The John Birch Society, today really the Tea Party, same sort of swath of the public, opposed it the same reasons. In Republicans, Bob Dole voted against Medicare, Donald Rumsfeld voted against Medicare, Gerald Ford voted against Medicare, Strom Thurmond, all the kind of the big name or later big name Republicans that didn't much think that Medicare served this country. And since then, every chance they've had, they've attacked these two pillars of social insurance, Medicare and Social Security. In 1995, the first time since the 1950s, since the early 50s, when Republicans controlled both houses of Congress, Newt Gingrich tried to privatize Medicare. Remember that in 1995, and the government shutdown was peripherally or more than peripherally related to that. The next time they had a chance in 2003, George Bush partially succeeded with the prescription drug benefit, was pretty much a vehicle, deliver some limited prescription drug benefit. It's gotten a little better, but some limited prescription drug benefit, but do it in a way that partially privatizes Medicare. 2005, after the first time that Republicans had Bush had won re-election, they had a Republican House and Senate, they went directly at trying to privatize Social Security. They lost on that because enough people were involved, because Bell Likover organized them all over the country to fight back and make sure that didn't happen. So they have made progress on these challenges to the two pillars of social insurance. You remember back in the Reagan days when they first started kind of building the privatization message. Reagan said it was too early to actually do very much at that time, but they began all these conservative think tanks funded by whoever the Koch brothers of 1980s were, the Lamar, the Hunt family and people like that. They began to put a lot of doubt in the minds of particularly young people. There was a poll, I remember, the 1980s, that more people under 30 thought Elvis was alive than thought they would get Social Security. You hear those kinds of things that they were beginning to sow those seeds of doubt, and an awful lot of young people today would think that they're not Social Security ain't going to be there for them. I'm convinced it is, but they think that. So they know they've made progress going after these two pillars of social insurance, which has kept untold number of people out of poverty, Medicare and Social Security. So it angers them beyond belief, not just because the Democrats might gain from the Affordable Care Act, but as they have made progress in weakening Social Security and Medicare. I mean, you hear all these talk about all the things we need to do to make them viable for the future. They now have a third pillar of social insurance, and they can't believe, while they're weakening the other two, that a third one has been erected, and that a third one is going to be there for generations. So that's the basis. It's not really analyzed that way very often, but that's the basis to me of their anger about the Affordable Care Act. It's beyond reason. Their anger is far more than, it's not like a government takeover. It's not Medicare for all. It's not Medicare at 55. It's not even public option. So it's not far from Romney Care and not far from the Heritage to think tank, a foundation of their proposal of 15 years ago. But let me tell you why I'm optimistic, and then I'll close. In Bell's lifetime, there have been three kind of bursts of progressive energy in this country. In the 1930s, when we got Social Security, labor law, minimum wage, Wagner Act, all the things that happened in the 1930s. The 1960s and the Johnson years, 64, 5, and 6, voting rights, civil rights, Equal Opportunity Act, which included Head Start and many other things, voting rights, civil rights, Medicare, Medicaid, Higher Ed Act, Wilderness Act, all the things that happened that moved this country forward. And then 2009 and 10 with President Obama, again, a two-year burst of progressive energy, where we passed everything from Lilly Ledbetter to repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, to, of course, the Affordable Care Act and Dodd-Frank. None of them perfect, none of them as broad probably as most in this room or that I wanted either, but clearly moving forward in a progressive way. These were bursts of energy. They didn't last very long. They withstood huge opposition, very well-funded opposition from, call them FDRs, economic royalists, or call them the Koch brothers, or this opposition from very well-financed interest, oil companies, Wall Street, all of them. And they didn't last very long, but they have given each of those bursts of energy for two or three years, 33 to 37, 4 years, 64 to 66, 3 years, 09 and 010, 2 years. These bursts of energy have brought great benefits for decades. And we're still benefiting from the 30s, what happened. We're benefiting from the New Deal, from the Great Society, and people will benefit for decades from everything from Lilly Ledbetter to, obviously bigger than that, the Affordable Care Act. That's why, you know, Emerson said that history is a battle between the innovators and the conservators. Societies are generally fairly conservative because people are resistant to change. And when you make great change, as we did in 09 and 10, or FDR did, or the Johnson years on civil rights and voting rights and Medicare and Medicaid, there's always a reaction, and a reaction sponsored by the most powerful people in society fighting back. But we play defense, and we preserve these wins as we will now. I mean, we're not going to pass any major progressive piece of legislation this year or next year. Maybe we get an immigration bill. That's going to be awfully hard. It's possible. But we will continue to build on the gains we've made as a society. And I close with this, then I know that this is the audience that really doesn't need this description, but a civil rights leader in the 1960s said, don't tell me what you believe, show me what you do, and I'll tell you what you believe. Ed and Bell Likover, no better examples than they are of that admonition, show us what you believe. And that's why I'm thrilled to be here today. Connie.
All right. Sherrod and I were blown away when we walked in the room, because most of you were already here. And it's such a combination of familiar faces and some young faces. I get very encouraged whenever I see young people in any of our crowds, because I will speak to that a little bit more in a minute. Bill, Sherrod and I were interviewed briefly for a documentary they're doing that's including you, and they asked how we knew you, and Sherrod had his reasons, and I said, I have, at Bell's invitation, given so many speeches and never to the same group. It's advocates for women, it's advocates for children and families, it's advocates for the elderly. I have never seen in my immediate orbit somebody who has a broader reach. You're exhausting, frankly. And I could never give up because of you. I mean, I was thinking, Sherrod and I were talking last night. We just moved back to the city. We moved to the city of Cleveland. We're thrilled. And we were sitting on our porch last night talking about this event. And both of us, as I'm sure each of you in the room has had reason, we've had reasons to feel discouraged. And one of the values of events like this, I can't speak for what the value is to you, but I can tell you the value for us is it makes us have those hard conversations with each other even, and to focus, get that zero focus on not just what needs to be done, but why we're not giving up hope on what needs to be done. They're very valuable conversations for us as well, and I thank you for this opportunity because we had quite a talk last night, and it continued this morning over breakfast. Sherrod, you all know Sherrod. Most of you know him longer than I have, and you love telling me that. We've been married almost 10 years now. And when Sherrod first started flirting with me via email, and then asked me out, I looked up his votes on two issues. Because it had to be 100%, because at 45, there is no point going out. So I looked up his voting record on abortion rights and on gay rights, and he was 100% on both. But then I really got turned on by his repeated F from the NRA. So my mom, I've often written about how my mom raised her, because I come from a working class background, as most of you know. And my mother used to tell us girls all the time, don't marry him until you see how he treats the waitress. And of course, what she meant was how we treat the people we're allowed to mistreat is the measure of who we are as human beings. And Sherrod knew my mom had said that because I had written it in a column before we met. And by the time of our first date, which was New Year's Day in 2003, he had already met and knew by name every server in the restaurant and introduced me. So I had to marry him. I come at this as a columnist, and as a columnist, I say we have to, please, let's acknowledge our frustrations. Let's acknowledge our occasional weariness over what's, particularly what's going on. I look at it in terms of the state of Ohio. And let us even acknowledge our occasional bouts of despair over what happens, because you can certainly feel outnumbered, not by the reality of the numbers in the state, but by what has happened in terms of who gets to represent us in Columbus. And when you're a columnist, at least this has been my philosophy always, and I've been doing this for more than a decade now, there's no point in pretending that we're not feeling these things. I don't see how you can have an honest discussion if we don't first acknowledge that this is a really frustrating time. When I look at the number of issues I've been writing about for more than a decade, we pretty much could hit on all of them today. We still got a lot of problems, and let's start with abortion rights. It was so interesting to watch the Republicans run in 2010, and as you know, it was pretty much a clean sweep, and they ran on jobs, jobs, jobs. And then, according to NARAL's Kelly Copeland, in the first 15 months, they introduced more anti-choice legislation than they had in the previous decade. And that's a pretty stunning statistic to me. And all of a sudden, I'm getting all these invitations on talk shows to try to explain Ohio. And as you and I know, that really isn't Ohio. But that is what has become of our legislature in Ohio. I was in Columbus during the so-called heartbeat testimony in the Senate committee. That was quite a spectacle. They had a lawyer from Washington who represents the anti-choice side, and he got up and he started talking about Romeo and Juliet. This is a packed hearing room. You have a lot of rape survivors sitting on one side of the room, and he has already said that he knows, the statistics show that many rape survivors are grateful for the babies they can have as a result of their rape. So you can imagine the mood at that point among many of us. And he got up and he said, you know, if Romeo had known that Juliet still had a heartbeat, Romeo wouldn't have killed himself. And I wanted to raise my hand and say, all right, show of hands, how many know this is Shakespeare? This is fiction. Because all these members, they're nodding their heads and they're nodding in agreement, and you start to appreciate the surreal quality of the debate in this state. Here's why I'm still quite hopeful, actually. I'm all for the long haul. I understand that progress is incremental. Sherrod outlined a little bit the history of the progressive movement in recent decades around the country. When you look at, for example, the abortion cause in and of itself, last year, for free, I gave 14, I say for free because I don't want to be accused of making money off this. I gave 14 keynote speeches for Planned Parenthood last year around the country. Yes, we have three daughters and a daughter-in-law. I don't have to have any of those relatives to care about this. I'm a woman. But what I found so encouraging, particularly in Ohio, Cecile Richards told me Columbus, Ohio is the worst place in the country
to have a pro-choice rally. And I experienced that firsthand with her when we were in Columbus, just the hate and the posters, and it's all these men standing there, very old men, often. Nothing against old men, but I don't really want you telling us what we can do with our wombs. And the thing that was encouraging about this rally, though, in Columbus, and so many of these rallies I was attending, because I wasn't just doing dinners, I was often doing rallies, was a number of young people, particularly young women. I mean, a sea of young women in Columbus in those pink shirts, a sea of young women in Cleveland. And you know, this is what's been missing from the choice movement for a while. We have not been, I would say it is our fault, my generation, in order that we were not, you know, we do have to carry as we climb. That is true. We also have to pave the way for new leadership. Now, I love the story about your husband and what he said. After 65, you should have to step down. I think that we've been so possessive of the movement, and we're finally understanding that it doesn't rest with us. If my only legacy is my own success, it dies with me. And I think that we've had an infusion of new blood and of new young faces in the movement, and that I am encouraged by. I've also done a number of speeches in, of all places, Texas, for Planned Parenthood and for Annie's List, which is like Emily's List, but in Texas. And I love going to Texas and meeting with 700, 800 progressive women at once, because as I tell them, it's so easy to be a feminist in New York. It is so different to be one in Ohio or Texas. And it's such a tough group of women whose numbers keep growing, and they are raising a bucket load of money. What I hope to see is more of that activity here in Ohio, because I think that, I know we've got the numbers. I mean, look at this room, look how many women and men who support women are in this room alone. We are there, but we have to get more organized, I think, in raising money. It is about the money. We talk a lot about the right and their money and their capabilities with Karl Rove and the Koch brothers, and we certainly experienced it firsthand last year, and he won. I love to say that. I'd like to point it out. And sadly, it often is about the money. It's how you get your message out. I also want to say thank you. We've already mentioned the ACLU and bringing suit last week. I cannot tell you how many emails I had about that, including our middle daughter, Elizabeth, first thing in the morning, as soon as I heard so many women around the country hearing that Ohio ACLU had done this. You can't know, as much as, I mean, you're doing it for the right reasons. What you can't know, what I think is hard to comprehend, is the message of hope that is telegraphing across the state and across the country for people who care about women in Ohio. So thank you, ACLU. We had some very troubling, more troubling news, but specific to the criminal justice system this week. Ariel Castro. I would never be in a position of ever defending that man. However, as we have found out this week, it appears that he died, perhaps accidentally, and it appears that the evidence of this was falsified by officials in the prison system. I have been writing about the criminal justice system in Ohio since 2002, when my series, A Burden of Innocence, came out about Michael Green, who was an African-American man falsely incarcerated for rape he did not commit. He was in prison for 13 years, and he got out through the Innocence Project out of New York. What struck me, many of you, how many of you are on Facebook with me? Because I run it's nice to see all of you in person. So as you know, we run a public discussion there every day. We have various topics we wrestle with, and we also have pictures of Franklin, our dog. Because I'm looking for building bridges wherever I can, and there's that man who couldn't understand why I was the way I was with Rick Santorum. He was responding to an essay I'd written about our dog, Franklin. So what I found astonishing, and I actually noted it in the discussion on Facebook past week about the Ariel Castro finding, was that so many people just want to say, good, who cares how he died, and we're so glad he was gone. And I finally said, I am really surprised, I'm taken aback by how few are concerned about the state of our criminal justice system, where this could have happened, where they could have just falsified the records. Thank God for the independent investigation. And then, of course, people start responding more, but it made me aware yet again of the importance of the conversation, of the importance of being willing to say the unpopular thing, risking being accused of defending Ariel Castro, which I would never do. However, I will always defend his right to a fair trial, because that's how we make sure you and I get them if we ever need them. So one of the things I've talked about a lot in the last few years, not very successful so far in Ohio, Dean, boys, but I would love to see more innocence projects at law schools in the state of Ohio. As it stands right now, I believe we still only have one, is that correct, in Cincinnati, the University of Cincinnati? One of the best ways to tackle injustice in a state is to have an innocence project in your community. It's not just that, it advocates. It's not just that it advocates for those who, overwhelmingly the population of the wrongly incarcerated are African-American males who had no resources. They tend to have grown up in poverty. But there's more than that. It's not just those particular clients. You are educating an entire group of law students who learn how to advocate against all odds. It can appear to be against all odds sometimes. And it is that you plant that seed early. You plant it when they're in law school and trying to figure out what will they make of these legal careers for the rest of their lives. And you also send a signal to your whole community. We stand for justice. We don't stand just for educating lawyers. We stand for justice. It's an enormous undertaking. I do not want to diminish the responsibility involved in doing so. But I really would encourage, again, and those of you who have graduated from law schools, to encourage your law schools where you've come from, particularly if they're in Ohio. We do need more innocence projects here in this state. I have a stack. After I wrote about Michael Green, they reopened more than 100 cases because that was part of the settlement agreement Michael made with the city. He wanted those cases reopened where they had the same chemical, I forget the name of the title of the man who was doing the chemical samples, and they were finding one case after another, not a ton of them, but enough of them to raise the issue of this particular person being involved. And so it matters to me because I got to know Michael Green so well, and I know this, that when they get out, their lives are never the same. We want that fairy tale. We want them to be exonerated and then to go on their lives and they get to, but it's so hard. They suffer so much in prison. And so that's why I'm not willing to give up on it, but there's another reason. And it was reader response to the Michael Green series. When we ran that series, there was a lot of discussion before it ran, what are we gonna do with the racist male? Because typically you write, and if you're advocating, and the three starring characters, I call them characters just because it was done in a narrative form, were all African-American men. Michael Green, his stepfather who helped find the evidence that freed him, and the man in prison, Mr. Freeman, who helped him turn his life around in prison, a convicted murderer. So we had anticipated that the reaction will be as it always is, and it never came. No matter where the readers lived, no matter what their backgrounds, they were enraged over the injustice of what had happened to Michael Green. And shortly after the series ran, I became a columnist. So then I started advocating because we found out that the state wasn't going to pay him the money they owed him. They were jerking him around, and it was Attorney General Jim Petro who has reversed his position on this dramatically and written a book since about his change of heart on this. But what he said, even in his book, what got them to pay Michael Green the money sooner was not just that I wrote the column. That's not what did it. It was the reader response. All I had to do was ask. I laid out what happened. I gave him Jim Petro's email address and phone number. That's a little too much fun, I will admit. But it's the way to do it. And they were inundated with reader response. I am such a believer in the collective goodwill. And it has come almost entirely from my time as a columnist. When I write about a tip jar, and the person behind the counter is not getting the tips, more than 1,000 people weighed in by noon the following morning. That's Cleveland. That is what it means to live in Cleveland. And it was so many of them wanted me to know that they were Republicans, but just this once, they agreed with me. When I look at what's happening with voting rights, Sherrod and I were talking today, we're a little more optimistic in Ohio because the public and the media are with us on this one, shockingly, with some of the editorials. But you know, I can't help but think about how long this one's been going on. When Sherrod was Secretary of State in the 1980s, some of you may remember this, you could register to vote on a McDonald's tray liner. We were going to bring it, but it was going to be our only prop, but we forgot. Look what we've gone through since. In 2004, I wrote about Ken Blackwell, who was Secretary of State at the time, and also co-chair, Ohio co-chair of George Bush's, Kim, no conflict there, none whatsoever. And the Plain Dealer, we were going to run with my column, we were going to print the voter registration form so that we can encourage people to register to vote. And Blackwell's office said that they would not accept it, even though you could look at the statute. He was supposed to accept it. So we called all seven county boards of elections in our circulation area, and to a board, they said, no, we'll take it. We'll accept it. And that's what forced Kim Blackwell to reverse his position. And we registered tens of thousands of people to vote in Cuyahoga County in a two-week period with that form. That was really, again, that is Cleveland. I mentioned that Sherrod and I moved to Cleveland. We were heartened for the first time ever to change our registration online. We think there's momentum here. I definitely think there's momentum here. I love, Bill, that you mentioned, though, the importance of showing up to vote on this, in this election, this off-cycle election. I have a little bit of news that some of you may have read about that's coming. Another thing that's got me a little more optimistic, because one of the things that has most concerned me as a liberal, as a feminist, is the nature of discourse in this country. It will not surprise anybody in this room that liberals value civil discourse. One of the reasons I went on Facebook, and I think I have about 127,000 subscribers now, I don't really know why, but we have a lot of fun there, but the whole reason I did it is I thought, you know what, we really don't have to do these anonymous comments on Cleveland.com. I do not have to get into the cesspool with Red Dog Daddy. Who is that? that we can require the identities of people who want to weigh in and still have very spirited discussions. And we do every day on Facebook. PolitiFact has not been perfect. However, I agreed when the Pulitzer Committee awarded the Pulitzer to PolitiFact, because it's a group of journalists who have been working very hard to bring a nonpartisan approach to fact-checking. And if you get annoyed with PolitiFact on occasion, please keep in mind that where they get constant pressure and lobbying is from the right. I mean, because it's pretty clear what has happened. If you look at the ratings and the pants on fire and the half true and all, overwhelmingly, it's the conservative side that's telling more lies. And that's why they decided PolitiFact is liberal. Love that logic. PolitiFact has just launched, as of last week, and I was part of, the week before, I was in St. Petersburg, Florida. They gathered about a dozen of us from around the country who had some familiarity with PolitiFact or had been involved in some way to gather to brainstorm for the last time before they launched this. They're going to have PundiFact, which means they're going to start fact-checking the pundits and the columnists. And if you think elected officials got mad at the fact-checking, I told the two founders of PolitiFact, when they talked about PundiFact, I said, you are really in for it. But it is a wonderful opportunity to see how it plays out and who lies and who doesn't. But here's the thing I would ask of you. Follow it. You can go online and you can sign up for PundiFact. Spread the word. And if you disagree with the rating, let them know. They read every single email they get. And they take them very seriously when people object or think they've made a mistake, and occasionally they've changed their rating. But I do encourage you to participate with it, and I encourage you to spread the word. Because if we start, the thing that's happened with our national discourse is the pundits have taken over. Newspapers have cut their staffs, I don't need to tell you that. They've cut their reporting staffs dramatically. So we have television stations, local television stations. So increasingly, the loudest horn takes up the most measures. And so it's very important, I think, to be fact-checking the opinion makers. If I were to say one bright light in the state of Ohio, I am so encouraged with the prospect of same-sex marriage in this state. Yeah. And I say this as someone, you'll remember, this was one of the Pulitzer columns, actually it was 2004, remember issue one? I will never forget the Sunday after that vote, because of course John Kerry had lost the race. Issue one, the most hateful, it was constantly identified as that. Of the 11 such initiatives around the country, ours was the worst. Because you already couldn't marry if you were gay in Ohio. We just wanted to, it was kind of like a, so there, this is how much we hate you. We're gonna have a referendum on it too. It was ugly, ugly. And at that time, Sherrod and I were attending Pilgrim Church in the Tremont neighborhood, UCC Church, was where we were married. And Lori Hafner was the head pastor there at the time. But before she got up to speak, we listened to the choir director got up and led us a cappella in a song. The head of stewardship got up to talk about the drive for children that we were going to be doing. And then there was a Toys for Tots kind of thing program by another man who got up. Lori got up, Pastor Hafner, and she wanted to, the congregation was about a fourth gay, right? On any given Sunday, about a fourth. And we were all sitting there, and she knew to start the service, she knew to talk first about what had happened with issue one. And she asked how many people were directly affected by issue one. And the choir director stood up, and the Toys for Tots person stood up, and the head of stewardship stood up, and about a quarter of the rest of the congregation. And assistant minister, that's right, stood up. And when you looked around and saw dozens and dozens of people, the church was packed that day, they didn't look angry or bitter, they just looked abandoned. And it all of a sudden dawned, I still get emotional all these years later thinking of it, it all of a sudden started dawn on the rest of us, we were all directly affected by it, and we all stood up. And in that moment, it was very hard for me to imagine that we would ever have the moment we are seeing now. We are hosting the Gay Games, the International Gay Games, next year. Huge, huge deal. The IRS ruling across every state in the country, partner benefits, you get to be a couple. And a Supreme Court decision. But more importantly than, I mean, you take those in the aggregate and that matters, but the thing is, it's the conversations that we're both having with people that never thought they would say to us, what's the big deal? In part, why? Because more people are having the courage to come out. I don't agree with Senator Rob Portman on much. But when he came out in support of his son, and I understand the criticism, well, yes, it's his son. Well, yes, it is his son. I understand family. And when he was willing to do that, I, on my Facebook page, encouraged supporters of gay rights to go on his Facebook page and start posting notes of support because he was getting vilified by the right. And I think that is key for us. And that's how I would end this part of this discussion. When we talk about activism, when we talk about not giving up hope, you know, especially when I talk to young people, they say, why should we keep fighting? Look what's happening in the state of Ohio. To me, the bottom line is this, who do you want to be when you wake up every morning? Do you want to be the person who keeps fighting, or do you want to be the person who gave up? I grew up in a union family. We had what, you know, I call it the Jack and Jesus wall. We had Jack Kennedy and Jesus on the same wall. My mom put her faith in Jesus. My dad put his faith in the Democrats. But the idea is that when you're organized, when you act in a group, there's power in numbers. There is always, because I came from the kind of people that you're only going to have power in numbers. And that's where I would leave it with you today, that we can be the bridge builders. We can be the ones who, when Senator Rob Portman comes out for gay marriage, we go over and we post a note of support because we lose nothing of our own integrity by saying welcome. We never lose a part of ourselves when we say welcome to the discussion, to the conversation. And that's what I'm hopeful for. I have two lines of a quote from the African-American poet Lucille Clifton taped to my desktop computer, and it drives me still. And I think about a lot when I think about how people would identify those of us in this room today, those who don't like us. What they call you is one thing. What you answer to is something else. And I am an American. Thank you. you. Thank you.
Sherrod and Connie, thank you both so very much. Hi, everybody. My name is Jason Jaffrey. I'm the development director for the ACLU of Ohio, and we're about to start our Q&A portion of the afternoon. But before we do, if it's all right, I want to recognize one person that came in late. You heard Chris Link, our executive director, and Jack Guttenberg, our president, talk about the really important litigation that we filed earlier this week opposing the amendments to the state budget limiting reproductive rights. And one of the most important volunteer attorneys and one of our board members, Susan Scheitzow, is here, and I'd really like to acknowledge her and thank her for her amazing work. There are a lot of heroes here today, and Sue, you're one of them. Thank you. So this is really exciting, because not only is this a fantastic chance to hear the remarks from Sherrod and Connie, this is a great opportunity for us to ask questions of Sherrod and Connie. And because of the size of the gathering today, which is fantastic, we're going to be following the rules of the Cleveland City Club, our friends who shared their ground rules for asking questions. You can find them in the back of your program. We have four colleagues here who have microphones. Do you want to raise your hands? You can look around. So if you're interested in asking a question, please indicate your desire to do so to one of the people with mics. Keep your question brief. The person holding the mic is going to keep on holding the mic while you ask the question. Just ask one question and put it in the form of a question, please. So we're going to move from this side of the room to this side of the room and then start again. So our first question is going to be coming from over here.
Hi, Connie and Sherrod. I had a question that sort of overlaps both of your fields in terms of politics and media, which was, why does media give the microphone to the most extreme on the right? And why don't moderate Republicans assert themselves to get more airtime?
Why, so the question, was why do the media give so much opportunity to the right, the most,
airtime
to the right?
And why don't moderate Republicans?
Why don't more moderate Republicans? Well, I'll let him address that part. I'll address the media. I don't know. I guess here's the thing. I feel like the left has quite a microphone at this point too. You know, with MSNBC in particular. Certainly there's Fox on the far right. The far right has taken over the radio airwaves. That is true. I guess I'd want to know more of an example of what you're thinking of, because I look at the media, if you're talking about the mainstream media, the thing that I push back a lot, but a lot of us did learn this from the 2004 race with Kerry. Remember the whole Swift Boat thing, and we really aired. He said, you know, and John Kerry has said he never thought he was going to actually have to refute those because they were false claims, but the media got caught up in just constantly echoing it instead of saying, this is not true. Part of the reason PolitiFact came about was because of the John Kerry race, because we started to realize we were failing. I will tell you, this is a member of the media, and until recently a member of a mainstream newspaper. Now I'm in a lot of newspapers, but I don't have a home base. The far right is very organized. And they work the refs, man. And it, you know, there used to be the joke at the Plain Dealer, there was pre-Pulitzer County and post-Pulitzer County. And pre-Pulitzer County was in the office every other week getting called in because they had organized, they hated something I wrote. And a month before I won that award, the editor was starting to take my column away from me. It is powerful. I do think the left, we tend to expect people to say smart things and they shouldn't be rewarded for it. But the problem is, if you're not being in touch with the editors, and if you're not weighing in on opinion pages and on the and setting and sign it, if you post online in the anonymous comment thread, sign your name. I find that such a powerful moment whenever I see somebody use his or her own name. So I think part of it may simply be, if indeed that is their perception, particularly with print, it's because they are responding to the pressure they get, and the left is just not as good. At pressuring, we just give up when somebody's real. I loved, you know, I don't know if you saw Ted Dighton's column today. Sherrod was reading it to me, defending. He said there's only one. The columnists have to be edited gently, but you have to have facts. And then he's defending Kevin O'Brien. And that's what I really miss being at the Plain Dealer and barging into Ted's office. But I'll let Sherrod answer about the moderate Republicans.
If I could, I didn't know I was allowed to talk about the Plain Dealer, but the, Ted Dighton wrote that he's the only conservative columnist. The Plain Dealer is out there on his own. Yeah, what he had to write, I guess he must not, I don't know. Eric, I'll talk about the moderate Republican thing. Barney Frank said that half the Republican, a couple of years ago, he said half the Republican caucus thinks like Michelle Bachmann, and the other half is afraid of a primary from somebody that thinks like Michelle Bachmann. And so the moderate Republicans, and their numbers, I mean, I don't know what a moderate Republican is. I mean, there are no Olympia Snows in the Senate since Olympia Snow. And before, when she was there, there were no Charles Mathiases or Ed Brooks or Pearson of Kansas or Clifford Case. I mean, there are no Rockefeller Republicans anymore. I mean, some say the Democrats move to the center and the Republicans keep moving to the center. I generally subscribe. I think that's generally true. But the moderate Republicans, the relatively small numbers there are, at least elected, are fearful. And fear, we met with the president last week to talk about all the shutdown, and he mentioned the number of people that fear for the future in this country. And I went up to him afterwards and talked to him about it for maybe 3 or 4 or 5 minutes as the room was kind of breaking up at the end of the meeting. And we were talking about how, by and large, fear drives so much of what elected officials do. And I think that particularly on the right, Republicans are afraid of primaries. They're afraid of being savage. They've seen the kind of mail, even when people have disagreed with Ted Cruz. I mean, most of the government shutdown mail and angry calls have come from the right against Republicans that might have said the wrong thing about Ted Cruz. Not even less directed at people like me, although we get plenty of hate right-wing stuff on every issue. But it was interesting that they sort of turned on their quote-unquote on their own a bit now. But that's what makes moderates fearful and why they, in my view, why they stay pretty quiet, Erica.
Well, I think that, we've been reading recently about this sort of thing, but the basic problem is in the redistricting obviously the party in power does, that gives you all the safe districts. Is it possible to do things to change that to get more representative representation?
Did anyone hear that question?
Yeah.
Yeah, Sherrod, could you repeat
that? Okay, that redistricting drives a lot of this, that he said all of you have safe districts. I wish my district were safer, but...
Is there a way to change that?
No, I know. I was trying to be funny.
Oh, you were, honey. I'm sorry. Okay.
I think that you're right. I mean, there was an op-ed in either the Times or the Plain Dealer today from some Princeton, I think a professor at Princeton somewhere else, that said that redistricting is not as big a deal as in driving this. I disagree with that. And I look at this state. The president carried Ohio last year by 3 points. I carried it by 6 points, thanks to many of you. But our delegation, the delegation, the House delegation is 12-4 Republican. They drew Marsha Fudge's district. Her district was already, I believe, 45% African American. They drew her district and 70% Democratic prior to redistricting. They drew her district pretty much down I-77 into the black section of Akron, which was represented by Betty Sutton, who was defeated in part because she had so few African-American votes that went in the presidential year with Barack Obama at the top of the ticket, went better than 9-1 for people like me, and I assume Betty and the president even slightly better than that. So redistricting is a big part of it. The state legislature in Ohio the same way. I believe Democrats, if you take the aggregate of state nationally, the Democrats voters, there are more voters for Democratic candidates for Congress than Republicans by a million, you're not, you're at million two, something like million votes, something like that. 1.4 million. So yeah, clearly redistricting is part of it. There's also what that op-ed, that column today or yesterday said, is that it's partly becoming self-selecting to people living. Maybe we're an example. We moved from Avon to city of Cleveland. You know, that's Avon. We were, I didn't win as many votes in Avon percentage as I won, and I assume as
our neighbors had your opponent sign, honey.
Okay, well, there was that. But it wasn't personal.
Is that why we moved?
But it wasn't personal. But the good news is after 3 days, the guy's wife made him take it down. Yeah. Just thought I'd throw that in. Comedy in the neighborhood, comedy with a T, not yeah. much comedy with a D in that neighborhood. Anyway, so I that's part of it. And I mean, we can do ballot issues on redistricting. It's always hard. Some states have really taken redistricting out of the sort of, you know, uber partisan way of doing it. I don't know if that, I doubt if that will happen in Ohio anytime soon. But there are two or three districts we can win in Ohio, including the one that the new La Tourette's replacement's running against a guy named Michael Egger, and that's a race we can absolutely win. It's going to be hard, but we can win it. So there are a few. There's one in the river that we could win that Ted Strickland used to represent. It's a worse district than when he had it. It's under 50-50 for Democrats, but close. And, you know, the Appalachia's a hard area for Democrats, but it's absolutely winnable. So, but it the problem is persists, as you said.
Two questions. Connie, you ought to run for Senate. That's not
She's got to quit saying such nice things about Portman if she's doing that, man.
The question is about the NSA. I don't like government snooping, but would you comment on this? What I've heard about what they're doing sounds to me less intrusive to me than what Google does with stuff that exposes my information to everybody else. I don't see the big deal. What's your thought about all that?
No, you go ahead.
You have a lot of opinions.
Yeah, I do have a lot of opinions. Well, I've actually, you know, I haven't written about the NSA thing in part because of my concern for how much Google, for example, can find out about us. I think we need to be having that broader discussion, and then you bring all the tech people who go crazy on you. But I don't know how many of you have ever gone online, just looked at something and didn't buy it, but then it keeps popping up in your, how freaky is that? So I would say this in response to this. My concern is that the president, this administration has really tried to close down any sort of leaks from people, including whistleblowers, and that has been disconcerting to me, to say the least. I don't feel, Sherrod, you can respond at length if you want to. I don't feel qualified yet to talk about the NSA because I think there's still so much we don't know. And I've had a number of columnists, we've been emailing privately among ourselves because we're all feeling that way. There's a little bit of how to find it out when there's so much being blocked in our efforts to try to, reporters have been going through this. ProPublica has been doing some pretty serious research on this. To me, it's an ongoing investigation on our end yet. But Sherrod, you may have a different perspective.
In your Senate race, he wanted you to comment on.
I'm never running for any elected office, ever.
I'm very mixed feelings about all this. I let me illustrate this way. I chair with a Republican from New Jersey a joint House Senate committee called the China Commission. And we just did a series of hearings on there's a group called the Freedom House, I think is what their name is, which is a bipartisan group that gauges sort of internet freedom in every country in the world. And China ranks, we rank high, but not as high as I think Norway and I think Denmark, or no, the Netherlands was the highest. We rank near the top fifth or sixth. Of the 100 countries or 80 countries they rated. The lowest is Iran, the next to the lowest is China. And we pointed out at the announcement of this report, the interesting, and these are you know, companies like Google have complained about what the Chinese have done with good cause, but American companies didn't mind going to China and—
Including Google.
And, sometimes at the behest of the Chinese government, if you remember that. And our whole policy towards China is very colored by the, you know, U.S. companies being on the side of the government and on too often on civil liberties and too often on economic issues aimed at workers. And you know, we need to sort that through, as our companies do, that have on one hand, you know, been in bed with the Chinese communists, and on the other hand, now see that government's a little more hostile to them and their business plan than they thought. So I think we need to sort those things out too, but I'm generally in concurrence with
you. You know, it's interesting to me, how do I say this? This is one of those few conversations that we have, and that I have with fellow journalists where I'm more quiet, because I'm married to a United States senator, and there's so often he can't even tell me a lot of what he knows about something, but I can see it even in his face as I'm opining about national security, that all of a sudden there's a lot I don't know, and there's a lot he can't even tell me. And it's really sobering. I don't know how else to explain it, because I care so deeply about civil rights and our individual rights and our rights to privacy, but I also know that the world is a lot scarier than even I want to think about, and that he has to think about. And I've never said that publicly. I mean, you know, I feel that way because he's not able to talk about some things, but it has made me think harder about it, and maybe quieter as I do my own research on it, less likely to neatly jump in on this one, because I think it's the dichotomy of the marriage in that way that has, because I didn't want to sound like I was avoiding the question. I'm not. It's just something that's been a little more challenging for me personally. We got someone else.
And I also sit on the Senate Ethics Committee. There's 3 Republicans and 3 Democrats. And every once in a while, Connie will read an article in the paper about one of my colleagues, and she'll say, "What's going on with this?" And I just kind of look at her.
He's being very nice. I'll say, "Oh my God, did you read?" And I'll be going on and off, and I'll be like, dead silence.
I can't talk about it. I mean, there's one person, each of the 6, and this committee, and I won't go in detail about this committee's pretty interesting in that if you sat there and watched, there's 3 Republicans and 3 Democrats. Johnny Isaacson is the senior Republican, or the who's the co-chair, Republican from Georgia, who's a really good guy. Pat Roberts and a guy named Jim Risch from Idaho, and the Democrats, Barbara Boxer's the chair, the co-chair, and then Mark Pryor of Arkansas, and I. And you couldn't tell which party, there's no press ever. There is one staff person who has clearance from each office, and then there's the committee staff, the ethics committee staff, and you could sit there meeting after meeting. We meet when called. We don't have regular meetings, but when something comes forward, you couldn't tell who the Democrats or Republicans are. It's really pretty interesting. One fairly major case, which I can't tell you what it is, but one major case we had.
Welcome to my marriage.
The Republican. I wanted to be tougher on a Democrat than the Republican members, and we got consensus more in their position than on mine. So, I mean, it really wasn't, and, you know, they were all, you're judging your colleagues, which is an uncomfortable position. But it really does say something about my colleagues that we do that fairly, I think, nonpartisanly and with really no cheap shots. I mean, I remember one time somebody made a joke about Joe Biden talking a lot. That was like the only even close to partisan comment I remember anybody in any.
That was a fact.
Yeah.
God love him.
Anyway.
Would you share with us your thoughts on Alan and its influence on elected officials and across the country, and the impact it has, and sure, influence it has on legislation and public policy across the nation?
Okay. Well, we don't know fully, do we? That is at the heart of that issue. There's been more written about it in the last 2 years than I think in the previous. How long has it been in existence, Alec? Oh,
30 years, I think. Long time, but not well known. I remember when I was in the legislature, I first hearing about it, I believe. The acronym is American Legislative Exchange Council or something.
Yeah.
And they, I think you can see its impact. I think Connie's right. You really don't know because they don't. You know, they don't do a lot of media stuff. They quietly work with their allies in state legislatures everywhere. But look at what happened. Connie talked about the abortion stuff early, the anti-abortion stuff. You look what happened in 2011, where immediately in Ohio there were attacks on worker rights, voting rights, and women's rights right away. And then look at Michigan, look at any state where there was a switchover from either divided government or Democratic majority into Republican majority and Republican governor legislature, how just state after state after state, they were all pretty much doing the same thing, some more severe or more extreme than others. I think that speaks to their influence more than anything, because they're the group, sort of the intellectual drive. Republicans have the conservatives more, Republicans are conservatives, it's not interchangeable there exactly, but the right-wing conspiracy that whoever talked about Hillary or whatever, I mean, I don't necessarily believe that, but they do have this whole machine of think tanks funded by the Koch brothers, funded by a whole lot of others, whether it's Heritage or ALEC or any number of the Cato Institute that are always pretty much singing off the same page. And they're pretty good at that, and it's funded in an almost unlimited way. I mean, the kind of money they spent in campaigns last year against many of us, with the lobbying efforts, with the story in the Times maybe 3 weeks ago that the Koch brothers and others began at the beginning of this year to understand that they were going to do whatever it took to stop the Affordable Care Act, and this government shutdown was really part of the plan. And, the media have been slow to pick up on that this was not an accident. Oh, we're going to have to shut the government down because the president won't negotiate. Well, that's not really the truth exactly, but they were planning it all along. But you're right.
Hi, thank you for being here. I just have a question. If you have any suggestions or advice for young attorneys who do want to go back to their law schools to start, say, an Innocence Project or get involved in other civil liberties issues, and what you see that like?
Well, I would love to see young attorneys such as yourself champion the cause of Innocence Projects at your law school. I think you got to find the faculty member who's willing to take it on full time. That's what I remember a dean telling me at one point when I was complaining that there weren't, I see you, Patty. Yes, that would be great. You need a faculty person. It's a lot of work, especially getting it off the ground. There is momentum once you get started, but again, you're always recruiting new students too. The thing is, I would love to see it at some of our state universities, our state law schools, because the population attending those schools tends to be ones who I would think would have, how do I say this? I mean, we have a daughter at Yale Law School right now, and of course, Yale Law School is incredible, right? And she's doing really great work with immigrants. She was also raised to do, we always joke that none of our kids are ever going to make any money for a living, which is why we have to keep working, because we raise them all to believe in what they're doing and to fight, for justice. Finding that person is key, working directly with them. The last I knew of at Cardozo, they're still willing to work with any school. Is that true, Jack? Still willing to work? I mean, they've got a whole formula on how you get started on this. And you start small. You pick one inmate. You start with that. And also, there are a lot of resources now at the University of Cincinnati, because they've been doing it for quite some time now. I can't overstate the impact that could have, because again, it's not just advocating for those who are falsely incarcerated. And keep in mind, when the story about Michael Green ran, a week after that series ran, the real rapist turned himself in, 14 years later. The prosecutor, the current prosecutor at the time, told our editor it couldn't possibly be the guy. The former prosecutor, who was a judge, said can't possibly be the guy. Why? Because they didn't want it to be the guy. But guess what? It was. And that's the thing we're fighting against constantly. There are many good prosecutors in this state. There are many whose only goal is to win at all costs. And that's why we need the Innocence Project. So it would be hard. It would be challenging. But you talk about a legacy.
I listened to Sherrod particularly outlining through the history of the development of Social Security and Medicare and all that, and the resistance to it. And I guess my question is, what is it about the conservative mentality that doesn't give a damn about people?
Explain that, honey.
Yeah, I don't know, and I'm not sure. Depends on which day I wake up, whether I agree with that statement or not. I one day I was walking home in Washington, and Connie was in Ohio, and I was talking to her as I do in the morning and at night every day when I'm there. And I remember saying, there was somebody that I'd presided or something that day, and I was listening to some kind of diatribe from a real conservative senator saying whatever, I don't remember what it was. And I said, I was trying to kind of struggle with this, that I didn't want to dislike them. And what we came up with was that it's whom you fight for and what you fight against. It's whom you fight for and what you fight against. Because I don't want to personalize it with my colleagues. One, it doesn't do any good. Second, it means it's hard to work with them on something else. I mean, one of my best achievements in the Senate was with Sam Brownback, who is as far right as anybody. He's now governor of Kansas. And it was, briefly, it was a legislation we got attached, an amendment that I wrote that he went with me on, that we amended Ted Kennedy's FDA bill. And it basically said, and I knew this guy, Kerry, he and I were dispatched as six or eight House members to go to Mother Teresa's funeral because of our interest in international health and poverty. And back, I don't know, whenever that was, mid to late 90s. And he, this amendment simply said, if a drug company does research and cures one of 16 most lethal, under-researched diseases in the developing world, that they would get a break from FDA approval on a blockbuster drug that could make them money there, so they would research drugs that are not lucrative for them. And it's already made a difference in people's lives in the developing world. And so there are, my job in part to represent you better is to look for ways to work with people that don't much like my views and don't much agree with the views of many or most of you. So. I don't know. I think they just look at it very differently. I mean, I think that they really believe these social insurance programs, that if people don't have those rules in society of well, regulatory bodies of safe drinking water and clean air and worker safety, that business will do it better. I think they believe that people will take care of each other if there isn't Medicare. I mean, I think history proves them 180 degrees wrong, but I got to think that's how they think about it, because I don't think they're not all mean-spirited, nasty people. They consider their, many of them have a strong faith. I think that I don't understand. I mean, I know everybody in this room is not a Christian, but I don't understand how they can read the New Testament and not see that Jesus would have done things in a very different way from the way they think we should do it. But I'm pretty perplexed by it most of the time, but try to get around it.
Part of it is, the reason we talk a lot about this, Sharon and I together, when he says it's who you're fighting for and what you're fighting, it makes such a difference for us internally. Because if you're always demonizing somebody else, we feel elevated. We're trying to. It's challenging. You know, you deal with a lot of hate mail, and I don't mean that to garner sympathy. I don't know. What I'm saying is one of the challenges is we have to remind ourselves often is the angriest people are the ones who are in touch. They don't necessarily represent the majority. We lived in a conservative community for the last 8 years. And as Sherrod would often say to me, this is a big part of America, and we're learning about it one day at a time in it. And they were learning about us. You know, the joke about us when we first moved in, we found out, was that we were going to run a soup kitchen out of our garage. And, of course, I go from 0 to 100 in the time I hear that. And Sherrod thinks it's funny, which is why we're good for each other. But I also realized that they had some preconceived notions about us as well. And when I said earlier about civil discourse, I don't mean that. I'm not just saying, oh, can't we get along? No, we really can't. I understand that on a lot of these issues. But if we can't even see, I think part of this is my training as a journalist. I've done an awful lot of stories on people I thought I wasn't going to like until I spent time with them, or I thought I had absolutely nothing in common with until I had to really do a deep dive and find out what made him or her tick. And that's instructive to me in this ongoing debate. And if I'm only on the left, if I'm just a loud, angry leftist, I'm really not accomplishing much. That's not my goal. I want to reach the people who I know are reachable, who don't think they agree with me on a lot of things, but agree more than they know. It's my job to show them where we can find that common ground. That's how we're going to win over more Republicans, because they're so disenchanted with their party now, so many of them. Those are people we can reach.
I'm still working that through with Ted Cruz. one other point about that. What's the most disconcerting to me is our as a progressive movement, and as Democrats, if I could make it a bit partisan for a second, is our inability to reach working class, white, non-union voters in mid-sized cities in rural Ohio. For the first time, I've been on the ballot in Richland County, my home county, where I grew up, lived there. My mom died only 4 years ago, lived there through all my childhood into the legislature. Until I was 30, I lived there. First time in 9 times on the ballot that I lost Richland County was last year. On the other hand, I never won Hamilton County, Cincinnati, until last year, and we won it by 40,000 votes. I won Hamilton and Franklin and Cuyahoga by astronomical numbers, higher numbers than we expected. So I'm very concerned about sort of the alienation of white working class voters in rural Ohio who were not able to talk to very well. Typically their children, if they get an education, leave those communities. Their factories have shut down in many cases and are increasingly non-union. So they don't have that sort of teaching moment that people like Ed used to talk to the painters in his union about. They don't think that Democrats talk to them, that we're elitist because we want to take their guns or whatever. But you know, they'll vote for somebody like me if I can reach them on the message of jobs or trade or Medicare or sending their kids to community college instead of guns or marriage equality. And we've just not been able to reach them well. And that's really our fault, because their lives are worse. Their lives are worse than they were a generation ago. And I don't think national Democrats care about that very much. And I know that in my caucus, and it really bothers me.
We're gonna take just 2 more questions. So here.
This question is for Senator Brown. The ACLU, Lambda Legal, and several other legal organizations have spoken out against the Employment Non-Discrimination Act and the broad religious exemptions. Would you be willing to speak on the Senate floor against the broad religious exemptions and the Employment Non-Discrimination
Act? I'm sorry, which on ENDA?
The Employment Non-Discrimination Act, ENDA.
What about it? Don't speak out on
the broad religious exemptions, which would allow hospitals and schools that are affiliated with religious organizations to discriminate based on sexual orientation and gender identity. The ACLU and Lambda Legal have all advocated for a narrowing of those exemptions.
So I'm sorry, I'm a co-sponsor of the bill. I'm not aware that, so the ACLU's raised objections about the narrow religious issue?
About
the religious exemption, okay. I mean, about narrowing the religion, okay.
Correct.
I need to know more, I don't know. But I, like I said, I've co-sponsored it for years. I will look at it.
And would you speak to the religious freedom and religious liberty that the other side has taken? And for employers, they've totally ignored employees and consumers.
Well, I think they've done that. I mean, I think often that has been a card that the right has played when they're opposed to the larger issue generally, and they will, you know, whether it's choice on the Affordable Care Act or whether it's, as you say, with ENDA, with the Employee Non-Discrimination Act, on this religious exemption, if you will, I think they typically are raising that issue, and too many people and on the right side of this are sort of. Are intimidated by it. So I generally think you're right about it, but I guess at an end I want to look at the language, but thanks.
I have a question for Senator Brown. Senator, can you tell us whether our Democratic elected officials have been able to do anything to show their support for the fast food workers around the country who are fighting for a living wage?
Yeah, I think a number of us are looking for ways to do it. I spoke with Mary Kay Henry, who is one of the leaders of that effort from the International Presence of Service Employees International Union last week about it. I have brought her in front of the Democratic caucus. I did a little program that I asked Carrie Reed if we could do on a Thursday at one of our lunches with her to talk about labor generally, but specifically what we do there. It's partly, I mean, labor, I always encourage labor activists and officials to call on us, people they've endorsed and supported, to help them in organizing drives of all kinds of organizations. Sometimes it's calling a hospital board member or CEO saying you should do neutral card, you should do card check here, but card check neutrality, or you should, or even sometimes it's walking a picket line, sometimes it's sending a letter out to potential bargaining unit. I think we're looking for ways to do that, and if you have thoughts about it, I'd like to hear it. What clouds this issue a little bit is that, you know, we pay a lot of Walmart in many ways gets taxpayer subsidies because of their low wages. Taxpayers pay earned income tax credit. That costs taxpayers a lot of money, the earned income tax credit. I think it should be higher. I think we should do more on the earned income tax credit. I think we should do more on food stamps. I think we should more on Medicaid. But with low-wage employers, in many ways, we're subsidizing that. So that clouds that issue more because progressives want them to pay higher wages so taxpayers don't subsidize those employers so much on the one hand. But on the other hand, one of the best poverty programs in America is the earned income tax credit and what goes with it.
Well, thank you again very much, Sherrod and Connie. Let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you.
I want to thank everybody very much for coming, and especially thank you, Bell Likover, for your hard work, for your activism, and for your courage throughout your life.